Hello, hello, and welcome back to Web Lexus. And today you join me inside a hybrid, but probably by the title of this video and the thumbnail, it's not a Lexus hybrid. We're in a competitor's car. It is a BMW 530e Touring, which means a stay or wagon if you're watching in America. So this 530e uses a 2-litre four-cylinder petrol engine, about 181 horsepower, with I think it was an 87 kilowatt hour battery. It could be 83, but I think it's 87. And yeah, it produces about 240 horsepower combined, just over 300 pound-feet of torque. And yeah, 0-60 high 5-second range. That's all kind of the stats of the performance. But the real reason I wanted to do this video for this channel was to kind of compare what it's like to a Lexus hybrid, because if you're a fan of the channel, you're probably a fan of Lexus. And as we all know, Lexus and Toyota, the parent corporation, have kind of carved out themselves as hybrid pioneers. They had the Prius, 21, 22 years ago now. And Lexus had the first hybrid 4x4 of the RX 400, and then they had the CT200H, which is the first hybrid, a luxury hybrid hatchback. So they've had quite a good few firsts in that, and wanted to see what a hybrid estate or wagon is, because Lexus haven't made one of these. So the main difference with this hybrid, first of all, is it's a plug-in. So because it's got a larger battery pack, it can run on electric battery alone for about 27 miles, which is actually pretty decent, especially if the price of fuel at the moment just passed a sign there, and it's 177 for a litre of petrol. And I think I heard in the news today we can expect it to be up to £2.50 in the next couple of weeks. So if you have a plug-in hybrid, that seems to be quite a good thing. As long as your energy tariffs aren't too high, you can plug it in overnight. I've done this overnight, it took about 8 hours, 9 hours. I've got 27 miles of range. Been driving for a little bit now, and we'll be back to Inverness, and we're sitting at 12 miles left. We're driving in hybrid mode. The car, as you can imagine, just like a Lexus hybrid, is using the petrol engine combined with the battery pack. I am achieving 36.9 miles to a gallon in this car. When I first picked it up, it was over 34, so I have managed to increase it slightly. But I would say, or I'd expect it to be a little bit higher than that, just because of the hybrid nature. But I will caveat that and say, because it's got the bigger battery pack, you can drive an EV. When I've been doing local runs, let's say to the gym or going to the shops, it only uses batteries, don't use any petrol at all. So that's a benefit of a plug-in hybrid in general. Which I've not driven the new NX 450H Plus, but that's the kind of first Lexus product that's got a plug-in hybrid ability, so that'll be nice to try that out. And I think on paper they're similarly priced. I think this is £56,000, and I think when I seen the NX and the configurator, it was £55,000 and £56,000, so they're pretty much in the same ballpark figure, although they're very different looking vehicles, and one's a compact SUV and the other one's a very large estate car. This is 4.9 metres in length and about 1.86 metres in width. So on these type Scottish B roads, it's not the most confidence inspiring driving, especially a big lorry coming the other way, especially if you're trying to park it as well in a big car park. It doesn't hide its size very quickly. Out the road, it hides its weight very well. So the BMW do throw a lot of technology at the cars, and I do like the fact that we've got a very large touchscreen. And the BMW iDrive system has been good for, well, I owned a BMW in 2014 and I had an iDrive. Mum had the 2013 5 Series and she had that for a few years, and that was also very good. No touchscreen, but all through the rotary knob. This has got a rotary knob dial as well. So you can do that, you can write on it for your sat nav, and you can also use a touchscreen. I know that again the new NX has just brought that in, however, by comparison, Lexus, and we've all been struggling with the kind of mouse pad, touch pad for almost feels like a decade now. So yeah, I think BMW win the point of technology, not maybe not the liability, because we all know what BMWs can be a little bit expensive when it comes to maintenance, before anybody shouts that in the comments. I do like the LCD display screen in front of us. I know right now Lexus have been kind of sticking to analog gauges, with maybe one part of it being digital, whereas this one's full LCD. You can get your map in there, your sat nav instructions. It's pretty suave in there, I quite like the look of it. You can probably, well, hopefully not hear too much wind noise come through the cabin. And if we put it into sports mode, so we've got sports, hybrid and electric mode in this car. They're all covered in black gloss, so they do get the fingerprints on it. But if you push sport, it comes up saying extra boost, which is quite a novel idea, but what it really does is gives you an extra 40 horsepower for like 10 or 20 seconds out of the battery pack. So it maybe allow you to overtake or something like that, but that means you're getting a little bit more of that BMW driving experience. It's very grippy, firm on the road. In terms of handling, the ride is very good, especially in these 18-inch alloy wheels and an M Sport trim, which typically harsh the ride, but there's something about this car. I don't feel any of the gear changes. It all goes through this 8-speed ZF gearbox. Don't hear the engine unless it's in sports mode or under hard acceleration. The 2 litre doesn't sound particularly great, but then again, in comparison to most hybrids I've driven, the 1.8 Toyotas or the 2.5 and the IS300, under hard acceleration, do they really sound that great either? Not really, especially the CVT. I like the boot space and the touring as well. The battery pack does eat it up a little bit. And again, it's hard for me to compare because here in the UK, or Scotland as well, you only get like the IS300H, the ES300H. We did have the NX300H, I'm not driving the new NX350. So every Lexus really is battery assisted, apart from the LC500 and then I don't know if they still sell the RCF, I've not seen one of them, but the 5-litre V8s, but I've not driven one of them to compare the boot space. And we don't get a non-hybrid version to say the boot space has been shrunken or taken a little bit off on the hybrid models. Whereas here, my friend's got a diesel one of these, and she's got two big dogs that you can throw in the back. And because there's like a battery pack, it's a couple of inches thick. I think it takes about 100 litres off, but I'm thinking if you've got a tall dog, the diesel or the petrol only model without the boot space being eaten up means it could probably stand taller if you've got something like a Rottweiler. If you've got something like a Jack Russell, it's not going to matter. So one last thing I wanted to point out is although the build quality is great in the car, like the cabin finishing, and I would say it feels definitely a notch above something like the Lexus ES, which I know that starts, well, the last time I checked, which was probably January time, about £36,000 or £37,000 for the base model. It's probably climbed up again, but I think this feels a little bit a notch above it in terms of overall build quality, but in terms of materials, everything feels a lot more soft and plush, because I know that the door on the ES has got the same kind of stitching, but it kind of feels hard, like a hard vinyl. This is very soft, rubberized, you can put your finger on it, it's quite soft, and it's got, I like the mood lighting. This is a big thing for BMW, it's the mood lighting, you can change the colours of it. Again, the ES doesn't have all that fancy mood lighting. But I will say, for the price of this, it still doesn't have, like, so this is over £56,000, and I've got blind buttons down there, which is a wee bit annoying to see. I do like the fact you get the climate control, and it's physical knobs you can turn, but I don't like the fact that you've got blind buttons reminding you you've skipped out on some options. You do have heated seats and a reversing camera, but there's no like surround view camera, no sunroof, no heated steering wheel, no blind spot monitoring, no cooled seats in this car. They're part electric and part manual. So there's quite a lot of mismatched technology in here. No heads up display or premium sound system as well, which is next three, we've got that. And you do get used to heads up display. Then I got in this and I was like, oh, you're looking down. But that's just a personal preference because I'm used to the heads up display. So I think if you're equipping this, probably same line with maybe like a Takumi ES, because I think right now they're just under £50,000. I do apologise if I haven't looked at the pricing in about 2 months, and the prices in here in the UK just seem to jump a blink of an eye. But they were about £48,000 for an ES Takumi, which would give you the blind spot monitoring, and you could pay extra for the cool digital mirrors. And really, that's a good proposition if you don't need the plug-in ability. I know it's front-wheel drive and this is rear-wheel drive, but when I've been in the ES, it's quite nice, it rides quite well. This rides really well as well. But you can save yourself a good, I don't know, like £10,000-£15,000 if you want a fully spec'd up ES versus maybe a mid-spec 5 Series Hybrid. Like it's a big jump. I know they're not the same like for like plug-in, but if you could live with just a hybrid efficiency. And as I said, this is now getting just rolled over to 37 miles per gallon. I'm sure an ES300H we could easily get, what, 45 to a gallon. The ES300H gets about 50, so I'd imagine a little bit extra weight, and while driving probably 45. So yeah, I've rambled on a little bit, but I just wanted to show you guys or tell you guys about this 5 Series. It has one for one, sunroof, a lighted interior, because I'm not a fan of this black on black. It does have a nice grey exterior, which I think is called Marina Amber Effect Metallic or something. It's a £900 option, but it is quite nice. And just whether to remember, when you just come to a roundabout here and you take your foot off the gas, it's got that regen braking, so you don't actually have to touch the brakes until there, and it just kind of slowly slows you down. So if you're not used to it at first, you kind of have to keep your foot on the gas if you're just driving along, because if I was driving to a diesel, I'd take my foot off the gas and let it coast, whereas in this, it just wants to slow you down and to regen the brakes, so you can quickly go from like 45 to 35 miles per hour like that in a few seconds, whereas in a normal car, if you were just coasting up to a junction, you can do that. So it just takes a while to get used to, but it's no bad thing, it's just something to reprogram your head into. But I do like the fact that you do get a little bit of energy back into the battery. So anyway, I've rambled on enough, this video's long enough. If you've got any questions on this 5 Series, let me know. I just wanted to bring the information to you on this 5 Series. Well, remembered as well, the claimed CO2 in this car is 33 grams per kilometre, maybe 31. So the last bit of technical information I want to give you guys is, if you're looking at this in the UK, this is only going to be 12% company car tax, because it's got a claimed 36 grams per kilometre of CO2, which in reality is not that much. Probably in real life, let's see, a video in Harry's garage or garage where he compares an EV and a plug-in hybrid, and it's all to do with how green your energy is. So up here in north of Scotland, it's all mostly renewable. It's all renewable in Scotland, whereas if it is something in the Midlands, I think it's like 300 odd grams of CO2 per kilowatt or whatever it is. I can't remember how he worked it out, but because they use a lot of coal and gas, so if you're plugging your car in the Midlands in England, it's actually not going to be as economical as you think of green driving. But it's something to work out. So it's 12% back. We're getting 36 grams per kilometre CO2 officially claimed, and we're getting about 32 claimed miles of electric driving range. So I've never had it really above 27, 28 in my time having this car. But it's kind of spring, 7.5 degrees. It was 13 degrees the other day, and I managed to get an extra mile out of the battery. But yeah, I'm rambling on enough. As always, I just want to say thanks very much for watching Rev Lexus. If you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. Subscribe to Rev Lexus below. Check me out on my Cars of Glasgow's my main page for Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And comment below what you think of the BMW 530e. Is it something you would consider? Is it something you like, or do you just detest BMW? I don't know. But if you're going to lease one of these guys, they do good lease deals. I'm not trying to sell BMW or anything over any other brand, but I have noticed their deals are a bit more competitive than this. I'm going to ramble on again, but I did notice I got an email through for the NX450H, and list prices are within a couple of pounds of each other. Whereas when I seen the NX come through, they wanted a £22,000 deposit for an NX450H, which is a lot of money. Like, I think a lot of people would rather put £22,000 down on a house. I think this is about £4,500 deposit, and then monthly payments are roughly, I think this was about £100 a month more. I think this was about £600 a month, and I think it was like £479 or something like that for the NX. But it's just, it's all to do with maths and figures. But I just, when I seen the figures for the deposit of the NX, I was a bit like, oh, it took me back about like £22,000. And it's not like an RX, or if you're over in America, an LX or a GX. Like, that's a lot of money to put down a deposit. And we've rambled on enough. This video's way too long. Thanks very much for watching. Stay safe. I'll see you next video. Ciao.